This video is my first video specifically aimed for second semester analysis, real analysis. We are going to start looking at the kinds of spaces that we will study in real analysis too. And one of those spaces, which will actually stay with us through basically the whole semester course, is Euclidean space Rn. So I am sure that you are familiar with the Euclidean real line R, the XY plane R2, and XYZ space R3. And honestly, those are the most important spaces and the ones where most of our examples will live. But as much as possible in this course, whenever we can state results for Rn, just general n-dimensional Euclidean space, we will do that. Okay, I expect you've seen these spaces in calculus before. So single variable calculus on R and multivariable calculus on R2, R3, and maybe Rn in general. You may have also learned what a vector space is, in which case you know that Rn is a vector space. If you haven't seen that before, if you're not coming into this course with a linear algebra background, it's going to be okay, but let me just quickly catch you up with a very fast definition of what a vector is. So very fast, glossing over all of the individual requirements, a vector space is one where we have elements called vectors. In Rn, it's literally vectors, like a vector in R2 or a vector in R3. We can add them nicely together. So vector addition is commutative, it's associative, it has a zero element in Rn, that's just the origin. There are additive inverses. And then there's also a notion of scaling vectors. We call it scalar multiplication, and scalar multiplication also works well. It's distributive, it's associative. There's a multiplicative identity, which in Rn is the number 1. Okay, I almost said the definition of a vector space out loud. If you need, you can pause and review that, or you can look it up after this video is over. I'm not going to go into the vector space properties of Rn in this lesson. What I would like to do is focus on three concepts, that of inner product, norm, and metric. I'm going to define those in the context of Euclidean space. They might be computations you've already seen before, particularly in multivariable calculus, but I want to kind of point them out again, specifically for Rn, and also connect them to each other, because in the next few videos, what we are going to do is look at a more generalized notion of space. So we won't always be in Euclidean space Rn, but we'd still like to have equivalent ideas of inner product, norm, and metric. Okay, before we move on, I would like to take a moment to just establish some notational conventions for Rn that I will use throughout the semester. Then we will define these three words, and then I think I have a couple quick exercises for us to wrap up this video. All right, so what is Rn? Euclidean space Rn. Well, you could say it's the set of n tuples. So it's the set of n tuples, x1, x2, through xn, like this, where each of these coordinates is a real number. So then the real number line, R sub 1, is just the set of real numbers. R2 is the XY plane. R3 is XYZ space, etc. I want to make a remark here about the shape of this n-tuple. Often we write them like this, where it's all on one horizontal line. Because if you're writing this down, it's easier to fit more on your page if you're going, you know, horizontally across with this kind of element. If you're in the middle of a paragraph and you write it vertically, it's going to break up your writing in a kind of strange way. However, dimensionally, you want to think of this vector. So this is a vector. Sorry. You want to think of this vector as an n by 1 column vector. So if you're looking at it and you thought initially it was a row vector when I started to write it, it's really a column vector. The reason why you want to think of that is that later we will act on these vectors with matrices. So we will multiply them from the left by, say, n by n matrices. And in order for that computation to make sense, you want to view them as vectors, which means column vectors. If I wanted to do a row vector, one way I might write that, and this might just be a me thing, is I might use square brackets, x1, x2, xn with kind of space like that, so that it looks like a matrix. I usually use square sides for a matrix. So it's like a square matrix where I've just spaced out the elements to say this is one row and n columns. Okay, so hopefully it will always be clear if we ever write a vector down, which we will lots of times, if it's a column vector, like a standard vector, or if it's a particular case of having a 1 by n row matrix like this one. Okay, let me think for a second. Is there anything else I wanted to say about notation, or are we ready to move on to our definition? So we have an n by one column vector. It's an n tuple. Oh, one last remark I should probably make is that by default, I think of these as vectors. If I have, let's say, R2, probably the easier picture to draw versus R3. So here's R2, the XY plane. And I write 3, 4 like this. It's a little ambiguous if I'm talking about the point 3, 4 or the position vector that starts at the origin and ends at 3, 4. So that's the vector 3, 4. So, okay, here's 3. Here's the point 3, 4. And here's the position vector for that point. Okay. Rarely will the distinction matter in our computations. However, the point 3, 4 is a fixed location in space. Don't forget that a vector is a magnitude and sense of direction. So this vector is the vector 3, 4. And if I slide it to the right so that I preserve the length of the vector and also its sense of direction, how it points, that is also the vector 3, 4. So whenever we do vector computations, make sure that as you write down vectors, you're not requiring them to be located a certain way. Or basically, when we get to writing equations of lines and planes and things like that, we will make sure our geometry matches the true definition of a vector, that it is a direction and a magnitude. Okay. If I lost you right there, don't worry. Whenever we have computations, it will become clear. I will talk through every vector computation we do this semester. I just wanted to point out really that this could be both a point and a vector, kind of depending on how you read it, and that it will rarely matter. And we will always address it whenever we see it. Okay, let's move on now to inner product, norm, and metric. Suppose x and y are two vectors in Rn, and you can see my notation here for those. Let's do inner product, norm, and metric. The first two you will probably recognize from multivariable calculus. The third one might be new. All right, I will always call this an inner product, but you might see other language like scalar product or dot product. What are we talking about? I will write x, y like this for the general sense of inner product. But when we're working in Euclidean space, you could also point out that this is the dot product. So what that means is pairwise multiply the coordinates of x and y and then add the result together. So for each coordinate 1 through n, we do x, I, y, I. So that's the product of their ith coordinates. And then we add up those products. Okay, so the result is a scalar. Let's go ahead and move on to norm now, and then I'll revisit the meaning of all three of these terms together. So what is the norm of a vector? Also called vector magnitude in multivariable calculus, that might be the more familiar terminology for you. Something you compute on one vector. So I can say, what's the length or norm or magnitude of vector x? And how you might think of this is the square root of the sum of the squares of each coordinate of x. So it's like take each coordinate in x, square it, add those up, and then square root the result. That would give you the vector magnitude. However, this looks a lot like this. So how I would rather think of this is the square root of x dotted with itself, or the inner product of x with itself. Sticking with that idea, let's look at the metric on this Euclidean space, so this Euclidean metric. It's really asking for the distance between two vectors. Oh, shoot, I just revealed the meaning of it. I was going to do all three together, but that's okay. All right, given that I just revealed the interpretation of metric as a notion of distance, let me use the general notation, which is D. So in general spaces, if there's a metric present, we will call it little d. It's a function of two inputs. So we're saying, what is the distance from x to y? And in Euclidean space, the Euclidean metric is to say, well, What is the difference vector, x minus y? You can think of that as the vector that points from the point x to the point y. It's equivalent. And then how long is that? Okay. So let's make some observations. The inner product was a computation that we defined. With that, we created this notion of the Euclidean norm. So we can say that the Euclidean inner product induces the Euclidean norm. And then similarly, the norm led directly into our definition of Euclidean metric. So the Euclidean norm induces the Euclidean metric. Okay, that's the first observation. The next one I want to make is that all three of these give us some geometric meaning in Rn. I already revealed that for metric, it's distance. So we're measuring the distance from x to y. Take a moment to revisit for yourself what notions, what measurements, what kind of geometric information do we get when we work in Euclidean space and we compute an inner product or we compute a norm? All right, as I already revealed, the information we get when we evaluate the metric function on two elements from our Euclidean vector space is the idea of distance between them. Okay, so distance. I probably also said this as well. My apologies if I spoiled the answer, but when we compute the norm of a vector, we're looking at its length. So we've got distance, length. These are the kinds of geometric quantities that we associate with these computations. What about inner product? I don't think I said this one. I also think it's probably the hardest to eyeball right away. And that is angle. So if you recall, for Rn, there's this formula with the inner product of two vectors, and it gives us a way to figure out the angle that they open up between them. Most importantly is when they are perpendicular. So if we compute that the inner product of x and y is zero, that means that they open up a 90-degree angle with them, or maybe one of them was zero. But interestingly, we can figure out when they're perpendicular to each other. In the next few lectures, we are going to look at spaces which are not necessarily Euclidean space. They could even be something like the XY plane, but with a different notion of distance. And we will revisit all three of these ideas. So keep these handy. As we look at that, you can compare, you know, are we measuring the same kinds of quantities? How does the definition maybe change? Does this implication still hold? So I wanted to first highlight the Euclidean versions of inner product, norm, and metric before we look in a more general setting. Okay, we're not ready to finish this lecture though. Let me do a couple of just short exercises on norm. So they're going to be exercises on the norm. All right, suppose we have a vector x in Rn. I want to prove these two statements about the size of the vector and the size of the coordinates because we will use these throughout the semester. So let's prove them so that we can use them. The first one says that if x is bounded above by some number b, then each coordinate is no larger than b. So if the length of your vector is 5, no coordinate can be larger than 5. Okay, makes sense, but we'll prove it. For the second one, this one is asking for us to give the best bound on the vector x if we know that each of the coordinates is bounded by some number b. All right, if you feel ready to go, you can pause and see if you can work out the first one and the second one. I'll start with A. So let's prove if the vector x is no larger than b, then each of the coordinates is no larger than b. All right, for this, I want to point out something pretty cool. Notice, if I want to take the size of the ith coordinate, that's like saying what's the absolute value of x sub I. Absolute value of a real number can always be written as the square root of that number squared. Okay, so that's what I wanted to point out. That is just a nice useful thing to bring in here because this starts to look like part of the computation for the norm of x. In particular, if I add to this ith coordinate squared, the square of all of the other coordinates, we're adding a bunch of numbers which are non-negative. If anything, we go up in size to, let's say, x1 squared, I'm bringing this in, x2 squared, plus xn squared, there we go. Okay, let me clean this up a little bit. All right. So the absolute value of x sub I is equal to the square root of that number squared. Here it is in the sum that I just wrote down. Because each of these terms is zero or positive, our square root is only getting larger. And then this is the actual definition of the length of x. Let me put it here. And then that number we know is bounded above by b. Okay, so that finishes that proof. If I were writing this down on paper, it was a little bit more formal than this context, I would probably drop in the phrase for each I, like that. Otherwise, this is all you need to show. The for each index I, the size of the ith coordinate is this, which is bounded above by this quantity, which is the length of x, which is bounded above by b. All right, this is a direct proof. That's all we need to say. For part b, we know that each coordinate in the vector x is bounded above by the same number b. What is the best statement that we can make about the norm of x? So this is something that we are asked to work out. All right, let's observe. I think what I will do is take the norm of x and square it just so that I don't have to write giant square roots. The norm of x squared is the inside of this radical. So that's going to be x1 squared plus x2 squared plus n squared, like that. Each of these numbers is bounded above by the non-negative number b. So if I took each coordinate now and replaced it by b, if anything, we go up in size. So this quantity here, the sum, is less than or equal to b squared plus b squared all the way through b squared. We go up in size, b squared plus b squared, b squared. There are n coordinates here, so there are n copies of b squared. This sum is equal to n b squared. Like that, okay? So that's a statement about the square of the norm. Let's just take the square root of both sides. Thus, the length or norm of the vector x is less than or equal to the square root of this expression, so that's going to be the square root of n times b, about b square root of n. Okay, that wraps up this look at Euclidean space Rn. We are going to keep working with these topics for the next several videos.